Welcome. Hey, thank you. Yeah, I was going to chuckle there because I almost said good morning. Old habits die hard. So wonderful to be here with all of you here in the sanctuary. It's so wonderful to be with everybody at home on Zoom. And it's just so wonderful to be gathered on this night of all nights, in this place of all places, and with these people of all people. And so I just welcome you, and I welcome you to come full-hearted, to allow yourself to enter into just the mystery and the enchantment. And for some of us, we have lots of memories that this night and this kind of place stirs up, to just welcome those and just to let yourself be overcome by the season, by the stories, by the music, by the words, and by seeing each other and being with each other. With that said, I would just like to welcome all of us, to invite all of us to share a sign of peace with those seated near you. And this is the kind of peace, not just like, how are you, but wherever you can connect in your heart that on this night of all nights, we hear that we are all one family of God, sisters and brothers, each of us. And that the peace that comes with that is beyond our understanding. So we say it in faith and in trust that in our hearts, in God's presence, we do have peace. We can have peace. So in that spirit, will you please share a sign of peace with those around you? May the peace of God be with you. Now, usually, for those, I'm always fond of saying that, you know, we do this every Sunday, but usually on Sundays, we stand up when we sing hymns. But when we're at Christmas and we're doing our carols, we don't. So I invite you, we can just remain seated. Please do keep your mask on even while we're singing. And the lyrics are all printed in your bulletin, or you can use a hymnal in the pew back if you wish. But let's begin our service with hymn 133, O Come All Ye Faithful. Thank you.
lighting of the Advent wreath. I will light the candles. I will light candles this Christmas, candles of joy despite all the sadness, candles of hope where despair keeps watch, candles of courage for fears ever present, candles of peace for the tempest-tossed days, candles of grace to ease the heavy burdens, candles of love to inspire all my living, candles that will burn all year long.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David.
He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn.
Kristen, you're on.
Excellent. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you, this day is born in the city of David, a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors."
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them.
I thought, probably like many of you, that we would be freer by now. I remember when this whole thing began, which is not just a line from Jesus Christ Superstar, but that some ways into it, Jill, who does a lot of work with Berkeley Rep, said, "Well, we're not planning a new season until fall 2022, right?" And I just, that sounded insane to me. Not so much anymore. But we did expect, you know, for things to be looser. And, you know, though they haven't been, we just definitely feel that a season, we're still in a season of caution, and that will serve us well. If you happen to catch the 5 o'clock service online, or if you were here for it, we had a bit of a Christmas miracle, that is next to Greg and Sue now in flesh appearing. And that is, it's our pageant. And we just didn't know how many people to expect and how many children to expect. Well, as it turns out, one family showed up and they provided the entire nativity story, angel, mother, baby Jesus, shepherd, magi. And to make it even more magical, it was the Wheeler family. And some of you might remember Thompson was baptized here about 4 years ago. And a lot of people remember it because he was crying in his mother's arms. And it looked like it was going to be one of those baptisms. And as soon as I took him, he stopped crying. If you remember that one. And we just were looking at each other through the whole thing. And I baptized him, walked up and down the aisle. And when I handed him back over, bursts into tears again. But it was really wonderful to see Jacob and Kim, the parents, and of course, Thompson and his little sister, Lillian. So one of the biggest things about this whole period is just missing you and missing our time together. And that's for those of you who I've known for 10 years, and those of you who I only see once a year or twice a year, and those who I see tonight and will never see again. Because together we make this magical moment of being together and telling this story and bringing it to life for each other again. I missed hearing you breathe and hearing you laugh. And if you think that I am, you know, talking about somebody else, no, I'm talking about you. I missed you. And I'm grateful. I'm grateful for, you know, everybody who made it out here tonight, everybody who signed on through Zoom. I'm grateful for Eric Uan, who, according to Wikipedia, authored the first code for Zoom. So I hope we'll thank Eric in our Thanksgiving prayers. So it's really wonderful to be together, and let us now come into this story and come into this night as deeply as we can. Will you please pray with me for illumination? Beloved God, we give thanks for this night. We give thanks for bringing us through all that we have come up against, that we could be here. We give thanks for seeing us through isolation and boredom, fear and loneliness. We give thanks for comforting us in our mourning. We give thanks for bringing peace to our suffering. We give thanks for our friends and loved ones on earth and above. And we pray, God, in this time, in this place, with these people, that you would help us to sink beneath the surface, beneath the glitter, past the commercialism, beyond the busyness, that you would help us in whatever way possible enter into that first century manger, that you would help us enter into that moment of grace as you entered into our human condition. And so I pray, soften our hearts and open our minds. And through the mystery of your Holy Spirit, take the words spoken and let them be the words we need to hear, each of us for where we are. All these things we pray in your holy name. Amen. So here we are, December 24th, again. For some of us, this is a cornerstone, a bedrock of our childhood enchantment. The perfect blend of special music, of the trumpets, of the organ, of the singing, of the decorations, of the colorful lights, the luscious smells, and I'm including the Scotch pine trees from my childhood. For some of us, it's a memory that includes church and candles and mystery. I remember going to a late service every Christmas Eve and passing notes and doodles with my sister, Janie, on the backs of welcome cards and pledge envelopes. And when the sermon started, I'd curl up and I'd put my head on her lap. And I was pretty much out that instant. And so I just want to say, if any of you are feeling a little nappy, rest assured, it is okay by me if you fall asleep. It'll be strangely nostalgic for me. But I do want to be clear that this indulgence doesn't extend to Sunday mornings. It's kind of like a Black Friday offer. So I'm feeling the story more this year than in other years, and I'm struck by this season, by just how long we've been observing this tradition. For many of us, we've been aware of this night and this tradition and this story that we tell on this night all our life. All our life. For some of us, that's a very long time. But it's not just been all your life that we've known this story. It's the whole life of our parents. For many of us, this same story was rolled out for our parents from when they were tiny tots into their oldest years unto their last breath. And your lovely grandparents who you admired and adored, your lovely grandparents who heard about this story when they were teeny tiny human beings. Do you remember the first time you saw a photo of your grandparents when they were kids? And for me, it was like, wow, where did those wrinkles come from? Where did that hair go? But even your forgotten or never known great-grandparents, they probably knew this story. My great-great-great-grandfather, as you know, a Presbyterian minister, no doubt wrote sermons on this story back in the 1790s. I know this story better than I know my great-great-great-grandfather. I was always impressed that my great-great-great-grandfather's sermons had survived 230 years in my family, that we still had these precious pieces of paper that he had written upon. But this story we tell tonight has survived 2,000 years in my family. In fact, your very own family may well have been acquainted with this story longer than the British monarchy has been in existence, maybe twice as long. Think about that while you're waiting for season 5 of The Crown. Now, 2,000 years on, the story, you know, it's lost some of its kick. We don't have to run away from that. We can admit that. In fact, really, all of Christianity has lost some of its kick. Maybe even a lot of its kick. I mean, for goodness sakes, we name hospitals Good Samaritan. When Jesus told the first story ever about a Good Samaritan, The words went together like Taliban and angel. I hope I've offended some of you. We blithely comment, forgive and forget. But if Jesus were here tonight to talk about forgiveness, he would be standing next to a gurney in an execution chamber, a thick needle in the hand of the guy trying to get around Jesus so he could administer justice. An unwed mother today? No, all the time. How many celebrities are unwed mothers? My daughter's teacher is never married with children. Back then, end of the line for Mary. So yes, the whole story has lost some of its kick. And so we have to try harder. We have to strain to understand the pressures and the anxiety and the very real threats facing all the people in this sweet little story with its sweet songs and its sweet pictures and its lovely, fun movies. I want to share a lengthy quote from a piece written by Michael Gerson that was in the Washington Post some time ago, but he captured something here I thought was important. He wrote, the defiant hope of Christmas is God with us. One of the stranger elements of the strange nativity narrative is the way an angel addresses Mary. You who are highly favored. As a teen mother pregnant before marriage and destined to give birth among barn animals, she might have been forgiven for regarding this as angelic sarcasm. Fast forward 3 decades, and the most favored one will see her son executed among thieves before a jeering crowd. The whole Christmas story is pregnant with enigma and violated expectations. The Creator pulls a garment of blood and bone. Almighty God is somehow present in a fragile newborn. The deliverer of humankind is delivered slimy with vernix in a place smelling of dung. If God can come here amid the shame and the straw, he can come anywhere. If God came here, she has come everywhere. As we pull back from these events, an odd violation of perspective kicks in. The largest figures of the time, King Herod, Emperor Tiberius, grow smaller. The smaller figures, Mary, Joseph, and some random shepherds, loom large. The smallest, most helpless figure blots out sun and moon and fills the whole sky with song, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill to all. Now I, Paul, think those couple paragraphs capture the impact of this story and of this night so well. And I have long been a champion of telling the dark side to our Christmas cheer. Sometimes I felt at peril. I just felt it was so important to make sure we understood why this story is so important. I felt it was so important to make sure we understood why a large swath of humankind has told this story over and over for millennia. I just felt it was so important to make sure we understood why you can imagine a direct relative of yours you know nothing about, but you have a good shot if you assume those unknown bearers of your DNA knew this story too. So I've emphasized the darker side of what was going on in the hopes that we might begin to brush against the incredible hope that is at the center of this story. I've felt that we must know the hardship, the beyond hardship that the people in this story were facing, that everyone was facing, so that we could have the audacity to hope. The English painter George Frederick Watts painted a picture and called it Hope, and you might be familiar with it, back in 1886. It shows a woman alone, blindfolded, sitting on a globe in a dreary background, playing a harp that was but one single string remaining. Hope. That kind of hope. The kind of hope that made the Israelites light that lamp when there was only enough oil to burn for one night. And yet, miraculously, it burned for eight. But they had the hope to go ahead and light that lamp at all. For the first time, perhaps ever, I've felt in this season that the most important thing to say about this very, very old story that I've heard all my life and tried to make sense of publicly for the last 10 years and have tried to resurrect the dark overtones, the most important thing that I can say about this story and why it's important to us 2,000 years later is hope. And the name that I think says it all is Emmanuel, God with us. And that's a startling concept, and it's best understood when seen from within a dark room. This is the story of hope. Hope not just for an unwed mother, for a bewildered earthly father, for frightened shepherds, for mystified magi, but hope for the world. Hope for peace. Hope that there will come a day when there will no longer be Jew or Gentile, Greek, slave, master, male, female, but that we would all know and be as one. Hope for you. Hope for you, no matter what it is that troubles you. If it's work, if it's finances, if it's the world situation, if it's politics, if it's relationships in your family, if it's missing your loved one. So I want to read two poems about hope in the dark places. And these are both written by a woman named Ann Weems. Ann Weems, her husband happened to be a Presbyterian minister. And her youngest child, named Todd, was murdered on the night of his 21st birthday. And she was especially close to him. They used to, you know, they both wrote poetry and would spend long hours reading their poems to each other. And they were both really interested in the world and in closeness to God. And it was pretty devastating. And she was pretty lost for a while until a friend said that she was a poet, and a friend suggested that she write a book of lamentations. And she wrote these two poems that kind of go together here. The first one's called Yesterday's Pain, and then Not Celebrate. Yesterday's Pain. In the God-forsaken, obscene quicksand of life, there is a deafening hallelujah rising from the souls of those who weep, and of those who weep with those who weep. If you watch, you will see the hand of God putting the stars back in their skies, one by one. Yesterday's pain, some of us walk in Advent, tethered to our unresolved yesterdays, the pain still stabbing, the hurt still throbbing. It's not that we don't know better, it's just that we can't stand up anymore by ourselves. On the way of Bethlehem, will you give us a hand? And not celebrate. Not celebrate? Your burden is too great to bear. Your loneliness is intensified by this Christmas season. Your tears have no end. Not celebrate. You should lead the celebration. You should run through the streets to ring the bells and sing the loudest. You should fling the tinsel on the tree and open your house to your neighbors and call them in to dance, for it is you above all others who know the joy of Advent. It is unto you that a Savior is born this day. one who comes to lift your burden from your shoulders, one who comes to wipe the tears from your eyes. You are not alone, for he is born this day to you. You are not alone, for he is born this day to you. And so I understand now more after all my years and years where I felt like I had dark Christmases, but I understand more than ever this old story that has gotten a little almost too threadbare to really understand it, to see it from inside the dark room, that there is hope. And fear not, for he is born to us this day. Will you please pray with me? Beloved God, it is so easy to be distracted by the many things around us that aren't going well. It's so easy to get stuck on the places, the things, the people, the words that somehow hurt us or confused us or made us feel alone or empty or angry. It's so easy to think that the darkness is a power unto itself, but any darkness is just the absence of light. And our sorrow is just the absence of your joy. And our hope and our promise is that in our darkness, as well as in the light, and in our sorrow, as well as in our joy, is Emmanuel. You are with us. And you have come to lift the burdens from our shoulders, and you have come to wipe the tears from our eyes. And so we pray, I pray, God, for all of us gathered here, physically, electronically, spiritually, that we would know when those hard places come that you are still with us, and that to us you have sent each other, you have sent us each other, reflections of your love and your compassion. We give thanks, God, for our lives, for our loves, for your presence in our hearts, and for these, the people you have brought around us, that we might remember you care. In your many holy names we pray. Amen. So normally we would take an offering at this time, and yet because of the circumstances, we're not passing a plate around. So if you're watching on Zoom and you have Givelify, this would be, we're going to have just a few moments where you can go on to Givelify. If you're here and you would like to, you can use Givelify. Or if you'd like to make an offering, there is a collection plate at the door on your way out. And if you want to, you can make an offering there and it will be collected after the service. We do so appreciate the support that everyone has been giving us this in this rather unusual time. And then for those of us who are in the sanctuary, we're going to, what I'd like to do is ask people, we've got candles, and what I'd like to ask you to do, this is going to work because there aren't a million of us, and I'm going to ask everyone just to get up and kind of make a circle, and we have two baskets, and I'll ask, may I ask Ellie and Julie to come up, and we'll let you just take a candle and come into a circle. And then we're going to dim all the lights and we're going to light the candle and just pass the light around, okay? So there's a basket and there's a basket. I don't know what's popping. You can use all those. Yeah. And we can actually make a circle as when you get your candle, we'll... Is that me? And then if you have your bulletin, and we can sort of interlace this in the pews. Hey, do we know what mic that is? Me? That's my headset? Not really. Oh, yeah, yeah. Actually, Mary, can you just bring that closer to me? On the. You know, I just trimmed my beard. I'm sure that's it. I can't do everything. I can't hold my paper and. I guess that's it. Here's the trick. A lighted candle never dips, okay? So you hold your lighted candle up and let the person next to you dip their light their candle from yours. Joe or Gianni, can someone get the lights in the back? Oh, Gianni. And so as we pass the light, we're going to sing Silent Night, okay? Maestro. Silent Night. Thank you. our last reading, I just want you to take a moment before our last reading just to look around at the faces, because we don't often get to see each other in the soft glow of a candlelight. When it's dark outside and this little tiny light just gives us so much to see of each other. There's an old story in Jewish tradition where there was a law about, you know, when is it dark outside? When is it fully night? And the rabbi who was being asked said, it's fully night, it's fully dark when you can't see the face of the person, that the face of the person next to you is your friend. And so I want to just take this moment just for us to remember our friends and our loved ones who are on our minds and in our hearts, especially perhaps at this week or on this holiday. And if we just lift up these names to God's ears, as we remember those who are close to us, they might be friends on earth or friends above, but those people that loved you into being and who are on your hearts right now. If you just want to call those people out. Or...
Bill, Lauren, and Laura. Virginia.
Bill. Mom and Dad. Oh Lord, we lift up these names and give thanks for the ways they touched our lives and for the handprint they've left on our hearts. May their memory be a blessing. Amen.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it.
Sisters and brothers, let joy fill your hearts and let's sing joy to the world.
Thank you.
let our hearts be filled with the wonders of his love. Let us go out into the night, but not into the dark. The light here shining in us and around us, God's light, forever enveloping us and holding us, remembering that life is short and we haven't much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey the way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And remember always that wherever you go, may the love of God and the grace of our brother Christ and the sustaining breath of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. And wherever you go, may you go in peace. And let the people say,
Amen.
And Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
And suddenly, There was with the angel a multitude of heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace, goodwill to all. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another,
Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us. So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them.
But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them.
In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them,
Don't be scared.
Don't be scared, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.